We must be in the South. How is everyone? Woo! We must be near NC State. Ooh, I had to make that joke. Sorry, I did a little time at Carolina, so had to get that dig in. It is so awesome to be here with you guys. First of all, I just want to give a brief overview of who I am and what I do. I got a PhD in 1993 and became a college professor at the University of North Carolina at Wilmington in a department of sociology and criminology. It's like, how'd you get hired? It's real simple. I was an atheist and a leftist, and they loved me back then. And then some interesting events occurred in my life. I converted to theism when I was in prison in South America in 1996. I love pausing. I was visiting. I was a criminologist. Everyone's like, God, what did you do? Who did you kill? Why were you in prison? No, I was doing human rights work. And then subsequently, I was on death row in Texas interviewing a rapist and murderer with an IQ of 53. And he read a Bible verse to me, John 3:16. I went home, read the Bible, and converted to Christianity later that year. Yeah, crazy stuff. Crazy, wild ride. And the good relationship with the faculty and the administration was over at that point because I've always been outspoken with my views, regardless of what those views were. And so I decided to start to mock the diversity movement because it is a joke on college campuses. There is such an absolute lack of ideological diversity. And so I'm just kind of being a little bit of a pain, a thorn in the side of the administration. And then 9/11 happens, and I got in an argument with an administrator's daughter. She happened to be a Marxist. Her daughter happened to be a Marxist. And, you know, they just don't believe in not only a free and open marketplace when it comes to economics, but the free and open marketplace of ideas. Heaven forbid that you should disagree with a communist on a college campus. They flip out. They try and invoke a speech code. I just don't think they build communists as tough as they used to, personally. So these are the people who want to start a Marxist revolution, but, you know, they don't have guns. It's kind of weird, you know. I do, just throwing that out there. Not on me right now, but I feel safe in this environment. So seriously, in 2001, little political dispute broke out, and the university tried to basically take one of their campus speech codes, an email use policy, and use it against me. And that's when I reached out, got in touch with the Foundation for Individual Rights in Education, and I said, I'm going to fight back. And that was the best decision I ever made in my life because there were no college professors fighting against this nonsense in America. And so the result of that is I ended up getting a column for townhall.com. I wrote for them for 15 years before switching over to the Daily Wire last year. And having a lot of fun. But I started doing that, and somewhere in the process, I got invited to be a moderator for a panel at CPAC. And I don't know, I think Pat Coyle was on that panel or something, and we just met. And for some reason, he thought I was funny or something, and he wanted me to put me on the list of speakers. And it's really cool. I've been speaking for YAF and different organizations for the last 15 years, roughly, and YAF is going to send me to Lock Haven University in Pennsylvania. March 21st will be my 100th college campus to speak on. Is that cool? Man. So that's what I do. And in the process, somewhere along the line, I sued my university for violating my free speech rights, for trying to retaliate against me. It was a 7.5-year battle in federal court. I won. Just so you'll know, before I start talking about these stories, I always win when I get someone to fight. But that's the problem, and that's really what I want to address, is sort of the crisis of courage on our college campuses when it comes to libertarian and conservative students and people who don't think like the administration. In this process of getting to know students and speaking about these issues and being an activist on 100 different college campuses, I've actually learned that we have three serious threats to the First Amendment. And I actually give this speech, it's on various campuses, called Three Threats to Campus Liberty. And I want to talk about them, and you will not hear the whining conservative up here talking about, you know, how hostile campuses are and just leaving it at that. what I'm actually going to do is share stories, victory stories with you so that you will know exactly how to respond in situations like this. And you'll kind of get an idea through hearing the stories what your rights are. Because, you know, a lot of folks just don't know what their rights are specifically when it comes to free association and mandatory student activities fees and speech codes. And by the way, that is a preview of the three threats to campus liberty. The very first thing that you face on a college campus if you decide that you're going to be an activist is that the administration will try to actually shut down your group before it even gets started. Many people think that the biggest threat for a conservative on a college campus is that they're going to get attacked in the classroom. I absolutely disagree with that. The most dangerous problems actually occur outside of the classroom, coming from the administration and the Office of Dean of Students. And the reason why they're more dangerous with their policies is it's not like they're attacking one person. They're actually often shutting down whole groups. And the first thing that they'll try to do is actually violate your basic freedom of association rights. Now, I learned what a serious problem this was on January 1st, 2003. That was the day that I quit talking about the ignorance of college administrators with regard to the First Amendment. I realized they are absolutely not ignorant. They are hostile towards the First Amendment. There was an issue that occurred at UNC Chapel Hill, and you know me, I don't like to use names, but Jonathan Curtis, who was this assistant director of student activities, assistant dean or something, he decided to issue just this series of threat letters to Christian organizations, mostly Christian organizations, and some other religious and belief-based organizations, telling them that if they didn't remove certain requirements from their constitution to be more inclusive, then he was going to throw them off campus, basically. And I'm going to exclude you from campus in the name of inclusivity, basically, this very Orwellian way of approaching diversity. Diversity is in and of itself very, very Orwellian these days. And he sent out these threat letters, and the only reason I knew about it was that a couple of the Christian organizations thought there was something strange about it. They contacted the fire. The fire did a press release, and I just said, I think there's something to this. And so I actually went and got a lawyer, and we did a massive public records request. I said, I want to get every single email that Jonathan Curtis has sent to any belief-based organization over the course of the last 10 years. And I just want to see if there's a pattern in the groups that he picks upon for in order to promote inclusivity. And I did this massive public records request, got 1,250 pages worth of documentation. And the stuff was incredible. In 1995, he had threatened the Muslim Student Association. He said, you can't say that you're opposed to homosexuality. Okay, now he was an LGBT activist, so he is definitely was one who was going after some of the more orthodox religious groups. And he first went after the Muslims, and University Council found out about it. And so, and she actually said to him, you know, you can't do that. They have free association rights. And he backed off. And it was incredible. The university attorney who told this administrator to stop, she resigned her position 7 years later. And 3 days after that, Curtis starts writing letters again. Imagine this pathetic bureaucrat sitting there saying, I'm going to keep this crappy state job for 7 years and just wait it out so I can harass belief-based groups on a college campus because I have nothing better to do with my life. And he sat there and wrote the stupidest letters. He told a Christian organization, oh, it says here in your constitution that you believe in God. Well, that's discriminatory. You know, you should allow the atheist to join and vote and be officers in the Christian club. And I went through, and the fortunate thing about doing this public records request was that I was able to get the email addresses of the various students that he had picked on and the various religious organizations. And so I started to email them and eventually call them. And it was sad because it took me 18 months to find a plaintiff, a willing Christian who was going to basically stand up and file a lawsuit. But when I found a group, boy, did I find the perfect group. Alpha Iota Omega. It was a Christian fraternity. It was only seven dudes, three black guys and four Asians. How perfect is that, right? I mean, how awesome. white liberal is saying, get off campus, you're not diverse enough. Oh, man, it was just sweet. And so it was kind of cool because they actually filed a suit in federal court with the Alliance Defending Freedom, ADF, supporting them. And they won an injunction in 5 months. So isn't that interesting? It took 18 months to find someone courageous enough to stand up and take a stand, and only like 5 months to actually win the lawsuit. And that should have been a signal to the University of North Carolina system, which at that time was 16 different campuses. But, you know, while Chapel Hill, because of a federal injunction, had to change their policy on group membership and basically leave people alone and allow them in their constitutions to say whatever they believe in and just kind of express that, it should have been a signal throughout the entire system that that was a policy that all 16 campuses needed to have. But that wasn't the case. 13 of the 16 campuses in the UNC system retained unconstitutional policies concerning student constitutions. And I didn't know that until 2012. And I was sitting in my office at UNC Wilmington, minding my own business, as usual. Just kidding. And I'm sitting there, and I just agreed to be the faculty advisor for a really cool Christian organization called Ratio Christi. I love this bunch of guys because they do Christian apologetics, and it's intellectual stuff, and they also do a lot of hot-button issues and abortion and things like that. They'll do debates, and they tried to come up with their constitution there, and the president, whose name was Madison, that's kind of cool, right? For First Amendment purposes, but Madison was told, taken into this dark room and told, we've seen your constitution and we don't like it because it says that, you know, in order to be an officer in Ratio Christi, you have to subscribe to Orthodox Christian beliefs. And so she did the right thing and she called me and I picked up the phone and I'm like, oh, really? You know, are you actually going to do that? Really going to hold up this Christian club? You know, for the same reason that got you in trouble at UNC Chapel Hill, are you really going to do that? And so what I did was to file another public records request. I think when they started to harass Ratio Christi, I honestly don't think they knew who the advisor was at that point, and that history was definitely about to repeat itself if necessary. But it was really something because I did a public records request, same thing. I asked for all the emails over the last 10 years with regard to, you know, what were the communications between the dean's office and the student groups about what they can and cannot put in their constitutions. I asked for a copy of every single rule concerning student governance and every single constitution of every single recognized group at UNC Wilmington because I wanted to see if they were picking and choosing winners and losers in the marketplace of ideas. This is incredible because I wrote that public records request on a Friday. They got it in the form of a registered letter on Monday. Guess what? In 48 hours, they convened an emergency meeting and they changed their policy to mirror the one at UNC Chapel Hill that we had won through a federal injunction. How cool is that? That the students stood up. It didn't take another lawsuit, did it? They won that case in 48 hours simply by picking the right advisor, knowing that something was wrong, and knowing that it was necessary for them to stand up and just not roll over. So ever since then, they've been doing cool things on our college campus. As a matter of fact, Ratio Christi is boldly sponsoring a debate on February 21st at the University of North Carolina at Wilmington between Dr. Willie Parker, a Christian abortionist who has killed over 10,000 innocent human beings. And he's debating me. And I can't wait. I can't wait. Don't you love that Ratio Christi is taking on all of the tough issues? They're not just having pizza parties and going and chalking on the sidewalks. They are engaging in the marketplace of ideas, and they are only able to do this because they understood what their free association rights were, and they decided that they were going to stand up. Now, I want to be very clear about this. If you know what your free association rights are and you stand up and you get recognized, there is a second threat to campus liberty that you need to be prepared for. And this is a serious one, and it deals with a case. I was talking to some people from the University of Wisconsin, and it deals with a case that actually came out of the University of Wisconsin. Let me give you some background. 2004, my very first campus speech out of 100, it was at UNCG, about 40 miles from here. And I was invited to speak at the campus, and they asked, you know, what's your honorarium? I'm like, I don't know. I've never done this. And I said, make sure you get me a hotel room. I don't want to drive 200 miles back to Wilmington, North Carolina. And I show up to give a speech there, and they actually, I found out that they wouldn't get me a hotel room or pay a single cent in their honorarium. And I asked the host, the College Republicans, you know, what's up with that? What reasons did they give? They said, well, first of all, they've read your column on townhall.com. They think you're offensive. And I said, well, at least they're reading. Okay, that's cool. But they said, we can't get funding because we're a political group. And so I told the president, I said, don't you know that the Supreme Court said they can't do that 4 years ago in a case called Southworth versus Wisconsin, or Wisconsin versus Southworth? And that case had gone before the Supreme Court and said, you know, your mandatory student activities fees, you might not like them, but they're not unconstitutional per se. Your constitutional rights have only been violated if they give the money back in a way that is not viewpoint neutral. Because of Rosenberger and Southworth, they cannot carve out categories such as religious group or political group and deny you funding. And so I told them that, and when I was given that speech, when I was there that evening, I found out they had sponsored a speech by a porn star the night before by the name of Tristan Tormino. And the speech was on safe sodomy, basically. And so I was so irritated with this, I wrote a column condemning the University of North Carolina at Greensboro and making fun of them for the double standard. O'Reilly picked it up on the O'Reilly factor, and UNCG freaks out. And they said, oh, it's not true. You know, Dr. Adams said we hired a porn star. That's not true. She's a sexual health expert. And so... So I did a little research on what she writes for the Village Voice, a sex column, and I found a column where she had written about urinating on people for sexual gratification. I ran another column after that, and they said, okay, she's a porn star. Sorry about that. She's not a sexual health expert. And we got in this back and forth, and those kids at UNCG absolutely fought back. And in the process of doing all this, being involved in this controversy, I found out they had a gay pride week for an entire week where they had a gay prom one night, where this was really interesting, where they were doing this for high school students. And so what I found out was they were collecting mandatory fees. Are you following this? They wouldn't give money back to the College Republicans because they were political. Instead, they were giving money to high school students who didn't actually attend the university. Okay, this is absolutely illegal. And so we fought back and forth with them in the court of public opinion, and it was cool. They were getting so badly embarrassed that they decided to sponsor a morals week there at UNCG, and they gave it the exact same funding. It was put on by the College Republicans, and I thought it was really cool because they continued having that thing for years, and one of the things that they did was a pro-life day. And it was really awesome because after they spent $3,000 on the porn star, they invited me back to UNCG, and they demanded that I get an honorarium of $3,000. I thought that was pretty cool. I bought a .30-06 is one thing I did with it. But I actually gave $2,000 back to the UNCG College Republicans, and they started a conservative newspaper on campus. And it was really cool to see these liberal administrators trying to shut down the marketplace of ideas and the college students actually expanding the marketplace of ideas. It was an incredible success, but only because, not just because they found out that their rights were being violated, but because they were angry enough about it to take a stand. It was righteous anger, and they decided to respond. And I want you to know that this kind of abuse of Southworth continues to this day. 2 years ago, I was invited to California State University at San Marcos near San Diego, and it was the Students for Life wanted me to give just a basic pro-life apologetic, and basically, when I was invited, they said, well, we're sorry, but we're not going to fund your speaker because we just don't fund speakers at all, and they collected mandatory fees, but they said they wouldn't fund speakers, and I just thought, you know, that really couldn't possibly be true. And so what I decided to do was to call my friends at the ADF, and we started to do a little bit of investigation. And it was really incredible. We found out that there were 17,000 students at California State University, San Marcos. They were being charged $75 a year in a mandatory student activity fee. Now, at UNC Wilmington, it's hundreds and hundreds of dollars. And at some schools, by the way, it's above $1,000 a year. I've actually seen that before. But it was 75 times 17,000, that was $1.3 million that they were collecting in mandatory fees. And so we just began to look into where the money went. And it was absolutely incredible that we found out that they were spending $800,000 of the $1.3 million on their own salaries. It was the bureaucrats to kind of shovel the money around and redistribute it. Whenever someone talks about redistribution, there is a lot that falls through the cracks into the hands of bureaucrats. And so we were kind of looking at this situation and wondering, well, what happens to the other half a million, basically? This is where it gets interesting. They had an LGBTQIA office and they had a gender equity office. I actually don't know the difference between the two exactly. But we found out that together they were spending almost the entire remaining half a million on those two, what do I call them, offices, I suppose. And they were actually hiring their own speakers. So now we've got a problem at this point. The money is being collected from the students. We won't give it back to you to hire speakers. Instead, we will hire our own speakers that reflect our own point of view and no dissenters allowed. Once again, we've got a violation of Southworth and viewpoint neutrality. In the final analysis, in looking at the numbers, we found out of the $1.3 million, there was $38,000 that got back in the hands of the students, divided between 100 different student organizations. So what did Nathan Apodaca, who is the president of Students for Life at CSU San Marcos, do? He sued, and that case is in federal court right now. And I'm just going to go ahead and predict the outcome for you. We will win, because every single time we fight, we're going to win. And I'm going to go back to California State University, San Marcos, and I might drag Willie Parker with me if he wants a rematch. I'm dead serious about that. We have got to demand that we respond when universities think they're going to shovel all that money into their corner and only support their speakers. It is absolutely essential that we do this. And so you can see that threat number one is threats to freedom of association. They won't recognize you. The second thing they'll do is they'll try to recognize you but not fund you. Now you know, obviously, that the law is on your side. You know what the precedent is. You know that you can fight. Notice the pattern in those last two cases. Sometimes you win simply by fighting in the court of public opinion. It's so embarrassing you don't have to sue. But sometimes you do have to fight in a court of law. And the good news is that we've got people who will stand behind you. The Daily Wire, for example, runs articles about this all the time to make sure the word gets out in the court of public opinion. And our good friends at the ADF and other legal organizations are out there with step two if it's necessary. Now, sometimes we also have something else to battle that's really serious. It's kind of this third threat to campus liberty. And it really bothers me because I think it's the most dangerous thing I've ever seen before. And that's the campus speech code, where, you know, you win and you get your organization recognized. You fight for your funding, you get the funding. So now your group that's officially recognized on campus has an event, and then afterwards they try and turn around and slap you with one of these unconstitutional speech codes. Well, it's interesting because you gotta be careful with these things. Your university might have more than one speech code. I got my university to do an audit with the Foundation for Individual Rights and Education. I accused them in January of 2016 of having three unconstitutional speech codes. I will admit when I'm wrong. I will definitely admit when I'm wrong. I used to be a Democrat. But let me tell you, I had accused my school publicly of having three unconstitutional speech codes. I had to correct the record later, because when the fire did the audit, there were nine of them. And it's really incredible because you open up your faculty and student handbook. It doesn't say this is a speech code necessarily. Sometimes they're just a little bit hidden. But I want to make sure that you know what they look like by just sharing a couple of cases with you, successful cases. One of them was actually, this is pathetic, it was at a junior college, Spokane Falls Community College, back in 2009. I mean, you would expect, you know, you could go get your gen eds out of the way for 2 years at a junior college and kind of avoid the progressive indoctrination that occurs at a liberal arts university. Think again. Because the rot has just kind of dripped down, basically, downward into the community colleges. And this was a crazy case. I can't believe it's been 10 years. But these brave pro-life students there decided that they were going to, it was like the anniversary of Roe versus Wade, you know, so it's January of 2009. They decided that they were going to do it's going to be a pro-life presentation where they tabled and they handed out various brochures and things. But they were going to focus on the issue of race and say, hey, you know, we really need to have a discussion about the embarrassing history of Planned Parenthood. You know, we've got this Margaret Sanger individual who was behind establishing them and was just really this nasty eugenicist. And here we go. You look around America. I mean, good luck finding a poor black neighborhood that doesn't have Planned Parenthood set up right in the middle of it. It's a little bit disturbing. And then you look at the statistics, blacks are 12% of the population, about 37% of the abortions. And they wanted to talk about this. But at Spokane Falls Community College, they weren't allowed to talk about that or anything unless they had gone through prior approval. And, you know, I don't like to use names, so I won't, but Heather McKenzie, whoops, it slipped out, was the administrator who was in charge of approving of pamphlets and posters. Is that a pathetic job to have? Like, look at what kids are saying and put your stamp of approval or, you know, send them home if it offends someone. But she was presented with all of this literature, and she says to the pro-life group at Spokane Falls, well, you can't do this. And they said, well, what do you mean we can't do this? We can't set up and distribute this. What do you mean? She said, well, it violates this thing known as the triangle of hate. And yeah, you already know it's going to be stupid, right? Trust me, it takes a PhD to be stupid enough to come up with something like this. You're not going to believe this one. I mean, she had come up with this triangle here. Well, she got it from someone else. I've seen it on other campuses. But there's three levels. And the lower level was discriminatory speech. Okay, so the idea is you can't involve yourself in discriminatory speech. Why not? Because the second level is hate speech. So if discriminatory speech is left unchecked, it could lead to hate speech. Okay, there's a third level. It gets dumber, okay? If we allow hate speech to be unchecked, it could lead to genocide. Okay, now some of you see where this is going. She looks at this material, and they're criticizing Margaret Sanger, right? And I'm sorry, but you're engaged in discriminatory speech. Well, what do you mean? It was biased speech. Same concept. Well, what do you mean by that? What is it? Well, you're only arguing one side of the issue. You're only talking about the bad effects of abortion. Oh, I see. We're supposed to talk about the good effects of intentionally killing innocent human beings through a slow process of dismemberment. Oh, boy. I forgot about the advantages of crushing a human skull before you deliver it. Oh, my bad. But how lazy is that? It's like these leftists these days, I refuse to call them liberals because they don't deserve it. They're not tolerant enough to be called liberals. They are narrow-minded leftists. And how lazy it is that they demand the other side makes their argument for them. That is the height of intellectual laziness. And so they sense something was wrong. But I want you to just let it sink in, the stupidity of this. It's like she was saying, you can't just talk about the negative aspects of genocide. That was the angle that they were playing. They were talking about the eugenics thing. You have to talk about the good aspects. Otherwise, it'll lead to genocide. What, my goodness. what kind of sheer intellectual hernia results from the effort to make this into a coherent argument. They knew something was wrong. What did they do? They did the right thing. They got on the phone and called David French back when he was an attorney for the ADF. They sued. And at that time, man, Washington had an attorney general that had some sense. Washington State did. And it was a good thing because he gets on the phone and calls David French and he goes, I had never heard of the Triangle of Hate. I learned about it when you sued us. And I got to tell you something, I hated it. I'm going to destroy that thing. What do you want for your attorney's fees? Because this case is over. That case was over in about 48 hours. And so isn't it something sometimes you can just stand up and you can win fast? But I don't want you to make judgments about what you should or should not do on the basis of how easy it is. Because sometimes doing the right thing is the hardest thing to do. And no one knows that better than Ruth Malhotra and Arete Skar at Georgia Tech. Two great heroes of the conservative movement. I got to know them at YAF conferences over a decade ago. And they decided that they were going to protest the Vagina Monologues, not for the purpose of shutting it down. They thought it was stupid. And so they went to it, and there was all this filthy language where the women, the feminists, were encouraging women to call each other filthy names, including the C word, because it was supposed to promote empowerment. Ruth and Arete thought that was insane. And so what did they do? They wrote down every filthy word that they heard in the Vagina Monologues, and they put it on a poster board in the union at Georgia Tech. And this is fun. They put up a table and then a poster, and they just wanted to start a dialogue. And they said, women are not any of the following. Can you imagine these Georgia Tech students walking by with like their pocket protectors and their slide rulers, the engineers, and sorry about that, okay. Engineers. That was a little too close to NC State to be making that joke, but you get the point. They are looking at this language and they're like, you know, who uses words like that? And Ruth and Arete were like, well, you know, we're glad you asked. This is a play that's kind of stupid. It's promoted with our mandatory fees, and we think there could be better uses of the money. Well, the feminists found out they were doing it. The Women's Center was there in the union just down the hall. Do you know they came out armed with magic markers? And they marked over the words on their poster board. Yeah, that sums it up. You're like, what? I'll tell you what they were thinking. They said that the words were a violation of the campus speech code. And so Ruth and Arete said, but you were using the same words yesterday? And they said, well, that was different. We were using the words as terms of endearment. You're using the words as terms of derision. And therefore, they violate the campus speech code. How do you like that? 1984 has arrived, where college administrators actually think that the constitutionality of a word hinges upon the thought you're having at that time. This is pure classic thought control in the Orwellian sense, is it not? They called me on the phone and said, what should we do? I'm like, what do you mean, what should we do? It rhymes with do. You sue. Are you kidding? And I couldn't talk him into it. David French drove, he's an American hero, man. He drove all the way down from Nashville. He said, I'm going off to the war in Iraq, and I'm going to oversee Al-Qaeda interrogations to make sure that basic constitutional principles are being observed. Can't you defend our Constitution here in America in air conditioning? Can't you do it? They signed up, having no idea that that lawsuit would go on for 2.5 years. And what happened in the midst of that lawsuit? They got death threats. They got rape threats. They were passing out Twinkies there in the dorm where she lived, where Ruth lived. She's half Filipino and half Asian Indian. And they were passing these out and saying, Ruth Malhotra, she may be yellow on the outside, but she's white on the inside. Free speech is a matter of white privilege, and if you're a good minority, that's what they were saying, then you'll support the campus speech code. But they were also calling her the B word in the name of tolerance and inclusion and in their fight against offensive speech. It hurts to try and think like these people, doesn't it? Because they are utterly lacking in principle. This is identity politics. And I'm so proud of those kids that they fought. What did they do when they started to get death threats and rape threats? They didn't quit with the lawsuit. They got security guards. And security guards had to take them to pick up their degrees at their own graduation. And they fought and they won. That campus speech code was shut down. It was declared unconstitutional. Judge Owen Forrester in Atlanta, Georgia, told Georgia Tech, you can't write another student policy, speech or conduct policy, without the express permission of this court for 5 years. Go to your room. He grounded Georgia Tech. You're grounded. Go to your room. Don't come out for 5 years. You're missing supper. And it was pretty cool. The next year at CPAC, I got a call from Ruth because I wasn't there that year. And she said, why did you miss the Reagan dinner this year? I said, well, I'm sorry. I'll be there next year. And I said, so you were at the Reagan dinner. I said, oh, that's cool. Who won the Reagan Award? And she said, well, you know, it's really interesting. They usually give the Reagan Award to one person, the most courageous campus or most courageous up-and-coming conservative in America. But this year they gave it to two people. I'm like, I ask you a simple question. What are you from the South? I ask you, what time is it? You tell me how to build a grandfather clock. I ask you, who won the Reagan Award? She said, it was me and Arete. The plaintiffs, they won. And they won $10,000. That's a lot of hunting rifles where I come from. What was cooler than that is she was done with school and she applied for a job. She said, my dream job is to work for Ravi Zacharias as his personal assistant. I'm like, yeah, well, I got a lot of dream jobs too, right? Yeah. Well, guess what? She applied for it and she was able to put down that she won the Reagan Award. She got the job. And now she travels the world with Ravi Zacharias and gets to go back to her homeland of India and see her family whenever possible. Isn't that incredible? I mean, the road is long and difficult sometimes. I know because I sued my university. It took 7.5 years to win. I know what I'm talking about. But I will tell you something, in the eternal perspective of things, that doesn't matter. You need to think eternally. You need to think about not only the direction of your soul, but the direction of this country. What kind of country are you leaving to your children and your grandchildren? If you don't fight back, I got news for you. It's not going to be the same country you grew up in. Are you beginning to see that already? I hope you're beginning to see that. But listen, these are three serious threats to free speech on college campuses, and you know how to respond to them. And I hope you know that you have a moral obligation to do that. The last thing that I see every night when I go to bed, hanging on my wall in my bedroom, I managed a few years ago to get a copy of my 6th-great-grandfather's discharge from the American Revolution. I have a copy of it. He volunteered at the age of 13. He fought under George Washington. He was shot when he was 15 years old, and he barely survived. Understand that the struggles that have gone before you to put in place the rights that you have that are now in jeopardy have been much greater than anything you will ever face. You have a moral obligation to stand and do something. I don't care how difficult it is. But I hope today I've inspired you to understand not only that there are brave students who have come before you who have succeeded, but that you have people standing behind you to support you. And I'm one of them. Thank you, and God bless you all. Thank you. Well, that was cool. Can I tell you, that was unexpected, and I don't get that back at my university very often. Are we just going into Q&A now? Yeah. okay, I'll tell you what, I'm going to go from the left to the right because that is sort of my history. Sir, fire away, unless you're armed.
Well, first, thank you, Dr. Adams, for coming here today and speaking to us.
My pleasure.
Thank you. My name is Matt. I go to the University of Florida. We're actually in a lawsuit currently with the university because they are trying to bar us from bringing conservative speakers onto campus, and that's just completely unconstitutional, obviously. When you were mentioning the Orwellian establishment we're kind of in right now, like the up-and-coming Orwellian perception, so do you think these people, like, for example, that said she's a Twinkie, white on the inside, and all this stuff.
Yeah.
Do you think they're just more like the Orwellian dystopia, obsessed with power more so than actually doing something that's going to benefit America? Do you think they're more destroy America and just gain as much power as humanly possible?
Yes. Yeah. It is about power. That is such an outstanding question. And I was actually serious about how in my life as a commentator, I've had to adjust with the way I was describing certain things. And I will tell you that a word I use much less frequently now is snowflake. And there's a reason for that. I mean, we have a tendency to look at the individuals, the leftists on college campuses who sit there and use these speech codes. And we look at them as being weak. And I wrote a column once, and there's some truth to this, in which I talked about how it's like reverse Darwinism. It's like the survival of the least emotionally fit. Think about it. There's an argument between two people, and the first person who starts to cry and throw a fit, it's like the university sides with them. And so the idea of the weak person survives, and the strong person is sent over here. So there is an element of that, I think. But ultimately, what's going on in the speech code war and why it's so dangerous is that every time a person goes to an administration and says, I want you to enforce this campus speech code, what they're saying is, my feelings are more important than your ideas. Think about that for a moment. Once you've said that my feelings are more important than your ideas, your problem actually is narcissism. And so actually you're this self-centered person who is going out there trying to gain power and destroy everything in their path. Okay, so I think you're on to something. Great question. That's my answer.
Thank you so much.
And from the right.
As always, first of all, thank you so much for being here. You said you hoped that your speech would be inspiring. I can't speak for anyone else, but I certainly feel inspired.
Thank you.
My name is Leo Brother. I'm a freshman at Elon University, which is a private school.
I know.
And I know that you've done a lot of your work. I actually have to see the Vagina Monologues next week as part of my required class on the global experience. I'm on the edge of my seat. I can't wait. But my question is that obviously fighting at private and public universities are very different animals. So do you have any advice for those of us who are at private colleges?
Yeah.
How to take that angle?
Absolutely. I've had the opportunity to speak at Elon twice, and the second time was fantastic because we had more protesters than people supporting me. And the cool thing was just the Q&A. They're the worst questions I ever had in my life. And so I actually just wrote a column and made money off of it. It's kind of funny, actually. But it was really bad. So I got a sense that night as to what you're facing. And then the whole thing later when they tried to ban Chick-fil-A and your board of trustees.
Get rid of the Chick-fil-A.
Yeah, they were afraid to stand up there, and that whole thing was crazy. But you're actually asking a more fundamental question about what happens on a private campus, because you actually don't have First Amendment protection on a private campus. And so, what do you do? Well, you still have legal rights. You're very careful. First of all, you have to be extremely careful about deciding to actually go to a private school. You don't ever go to one without doing a very thorough examination of all of their policies. So what will happen sometimes is that a school will say that they have a commitment to intellectual diversity, that it's a free and open marketplace of ideas. They will say stuff like that in the orientation materials. They'll actually say that on the website. So that if you are fraudulently induced into paying $60,000 a year and you don't get the thing that you paid for, that's breach of contract. And so what that means is you can actually sue in tort. Okay, now something else that you should remember is that you not only have that as a possible remedy, but understand that private schools, it matters a lot what their alums think. And, you know, that's an important source of revenue for them. And one of the easiest cases that ever happened, speech code cases, was in 2004. Around May, I think, David French actually was still the president of the Foundation for Individual Rights in Education, and Dartmouth tried to pass a really rough speech code. And there were people like Dinesh and Laura Ingraham who had gone there, and there had been a vibrant conservative movement. The Dartmouth Review, for example, that they both wrote for, that was a very successful magazine. And so some people got upset. My understanding is that one of the students there got upset about the speech code being passed, and he went and found a Dartmouth alum who was a seven-digit donor, not just an ordinary millionaire, but a seven-digit donor, and got him to agree to write a letter to the university saying, if you pass the speech code, then you've seen the last of donations from me. I was told he actually ran that off and gave it to his other wealthy friends. Let me give you a hint. Wealthy people tend to hang out with other wealthy people. And there were a bunch of letters that were sent to the school. I think that particular speech code lasted about 3 weeks at Dartmouth. You can have an organized donor boycott there at private universities, too. When you're an alum, you have to do something. While you're a student, breach of contract is a possibility, but later on, if you decide to go to a private school, you have to be involved in the alumni association and let them know that your contributions to the school are contingent on honoring important principles, even if they don't technically apply to you. That's my answer.
Thank you very much. We'd love to have you back in Burlington.
All right.
Hello, my name's Chase. I'm a junior at Pebble Brook High School.
Where is that, by the way?
It's in Atlanta.
Okay.
So my question, I guess, is, so you spoke a lot about the censoring of conservatives on college campuses. What do you have to say about the censoring of conservatives on social media, the internet, all that sort of thing? How can we fight back on that when these big CEOs, like Mark Zuckerberg, have even been brought into Congress to be questioned, and still there is no imminent change?
Right. Well, you know, I'm one of those. There are a lot of folks out there who think that, you know, we should apply the First Amendment to Twitter and to Facebook, and they'll sit there and argue, well, it's the same thing as a public utility, basically, and so they can't discriminate for that reason. That's something that came up. I testified before the House, what was it, the Judiciary Committee on the Constitution and Civil Justice. I got invited to testify before Congress on September 27th, the same day as the Kavanaugh hearing. So there was no one at my hearing. So it was a really bad day for me to be chosen to go up there. I didn't know all that was going to happen, but I testified anyway. And, you know, that's something that came up. And I was the only one who thought that Twitter and Facebook are allowed to engage in viewpoint discrimination if they want to. They're allowed to do that. Our conservative response is not to say to the government, you know, you're going to apply the First Amendment to a private entity. The idea is we're going to go out and create something better as entrepreneurs. That's what we're going to do. And so the congressman from, what was it, Reskin, I think is his name, from Maryland, he was asking me that question. He was probing me. And I said, well, actually, the only obligation that Facebook has is to be honest. And he said, well, I don't care about honesty. And I was thinking to myself, well, of course, you're a Democrat. But at any rate, I was trying to make a point, and he has a tendency to just roll over witnesses there. And it moved on pretty quickly. My point was there that there are certain causes of action that you can have. For example, you know, I have a public figure Facebook page thing where I disseminate my articles and things like that. And if I go and pay, for example, for a boost, and it's supposed to get my ideas out there to a certain audience, and then they do something like shadow banning or something like that after I've paid the money, well, that's a contract issue. It's not a First Amendment issue. So I think what we do with them is we create better alternatives. Also, we shame them in the court of public opinion for their hypocrisy. And Zuckerberg, you know, they threatened to take down some post that I made one time, and it violated standards. I just put it up over and over, and it was just mocking him relentlessly until they gave up. But mockery is good, and creating alternatives. And that's my view. I wouldn't technically try to apply it to them.
Thank you.
Thank you. Right. Fire away.
Thank you for coming to speak to us today. My name is Katrina Fee, and I'm from Haldane High School in New York.
Yes.
And my question is regarding your background in sociology.
Yeah.
What are your thoughts on the left's narrative of gender fluidity?
Oh, wow. This is just incredible. I can't believe it's happening, that the feminists in my department, for example, have decided to, you know, just jump on board with this. Because a number of them have done research in the past on gender discrimination, and it's based on a gender binary. So they sit there and they will talk about how, the average salary for a female is 77% of what it is for a male. Well, then they turn around and say that the gender binary is invalid. Guess what? You just invalidated all of your research for your entire career. If you say that the gender binary is meaningless, then your feminist research is meaningless. It's incredible, isn't it? But they seem to have jumped on board. And I'm actually, you're wondering, what do I think about it? I'm applauding this. This is glorious to watch them self-destruct. I mean, we had this HB2, was it the bathroom thing occurred a few years ago. What was it, in 2016? I can't believe it's been almost 3 years. And when this happened, you know, we had this resolution that occurred in the Faculty Senate. Do you know that we've got about 50 faculty senators at UNCW? And all 50 of them voted to condemn that House bill and to basically stand up for this idea of open bathrooms. And over the summer, one of my colleagues in Bear Hall at the University of North Carolina at Wilmington, a large male... I spend my summers, by the way, I live in Colorado and teach at Summit Ministries all summer long. That's what I do, and it's awesome. And then I come back to my freaky world in academia. And here is this guy, this large male, high heels, a mini skirt, long hair, makeup, earrings, and just struggling to walk down the hall, you know, to stay on top of these high heels and probably reconsidering the whole thing once he gets on the heels, basically. But the other day, I saw him just turn the corner and walk into the undergraduate co-ed bathroom. Isn't that something? Okay? They're having to deal. Ideas have consequences. Ideas have consequences. And now they're having to deal with this. And I am actually liking seeing them fly off the rails, just as I love seeing what's happening with the abortion bills in Virginia and New York, because a line is being drawn in the sand. And so don't be afraid when you see crazy ideas and you see evil things begin to develop in the society. The shadow proves the sunshine. When you cast your eyes upon evil, it shows you there's a light and a source of truth out there, and go and defend it. That's my answer.
Thank you.
And I think we're done. God bless you all. Thank you so much.
Guys, we're going to take a very, sorry, I just called you all guys. We're going to be taking a very short break. If I can invite all of the students who are either a student at a North Carolina school or a North Carolina resident to follow the staff over to the university ballroom. We're going to take a quick group picture for just the students who are from North Carolina or